In the year 1829, Ohio began enforcing laws to discourage black Americans, either slave or free, from entering the state. The laws made life difficult for blacks in Ohio, to encourage them to leave. It became illegal for white Ohioans to aid escaped slaves, and for any black or mulatto person to enter the state without a certificate of freedom. In response to this animosity, black citizens formed a society with the goal of finding a suitable place to relocate their community. They wrote to the governor of Upper Canada, Sir John Colebrook, stating their desire to purchase a tract of land upon which to live. Colebrook replied, "Tell the Republicans on your side of the line that we royalists do not know men by their color. Should you come to us, you will be entitled to all the privileges of the rest of His Majesty's subjects." After some negotiations, the council came to an agreement with the Canada Company. The settlers would purchase 4,000 acres in Kent County. While some settlers thought that the move to Canada was worse than a death sentence, many hoped that by escaping the urban environment, they could escape the racism that they had endured in Cincinnati. Upon arrival in Port Stanley, Ontario, and faced with a 35-mile hike through dense forest, most of the settlers from Cincinnati gave up on the idea of a new, independent frontier colony and settled in established towns. Only 5 or 6 of the families from the original group made it to the tract of land outside of London that would become the Wilberforce colony. The first year at Wilberforce saw very few settlers, but in time somewhere between 150 and 200 families came to the tract of land set aside for them. By 1832, after the arduous task of clearing the land and constructing log homes, the settlers had crops in the ground. The first institution established in the colony was a school. In fact, by 1832, there were 3 schools in the colony. The quality of education was so high that it attracted white students from the surrounding towns. As the colony grew, so did interest in the project from other Northern American cities. The new colony was publicized at the first ever Convention of People of Color in 1830. Settlers came from Boston, New York, Baltimore, and other cities. They created a board of managers to oversee the financial concerns of the growing colony. These abolitionists wanted to prove to white American society that freed black slaves would not become lazy and degenerate without the discipline provided by slaveholders. But this mindset changed the nature of the Wilberforce colony. It was no longer a place to escape American slavery, but instead became a place to prove a point to white Americans. Ultimately, it was the rift between the original settlers fleeing the Cincinnati riots and the new abolitionist settlers that led to the end of Wilberforce. As fundraising efforts fell short, and the ideals of freedom and self-sufficiency became diluted, the population of the Wilberforce colony declined. Most of the Cincinnati settlers left the colony after the first decade. By the late 1840s, the Irish began to settle in the area, and the black population declined even further. White settlers harassed and threatened blacks in the community to force them to leave. As black settlers left, Irish settlers moved in, sometimes even occupying the very homes and churches built by their black predecessors. Soon after, the town of Lucan was incorporated, and the Wilberforce colony began to disappear from public memory. Nikki Taylor, leading scholar in the Wilberforce colony, has this to say about the legacy of Wilberforce. "Those who reduce Wilberforce's existence to a label of failure would do well to revisit the goals of the original settlers, those from Cincinnati. The original objectives of the emigration campaign was to find a place where blacks might enjoy some civil rights and equality under the law. Even as they made plans to relocate, that definition of freedom evolved to include land ownership and self-sufficiency. Once the emigrants arrived in the colony, the community expanded its definition of freedom yet again to include education and political participation. If nothing else, this community proves that freedom was not a state of being, but a state of striving."